microphone?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Well, we are calling the order this second meeting of the Rockingham County Commissioners for the month of June. It's a pleasure to see you, all of you here. We've got some very, this is a very special evening. It's kind of emotional for me. I always like to see things done for veterans and also some real heroes from Rockingham County. So we will start our meeting tonight. Check your phone, if you would, to make sure we don't have any inadvertent noises there. So if you check your electronic devices, and that would be helpful. Tonight, our invocation is going to be given by Lance Metzler, the county manager. When I'll ask you to stand for that in a second. I'm going to ask Reese Pirtle, if he would, to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. So let's start our meeting tonight by standing and having our invocation.
You will please join me in prayer. God of power and might, wisdom and justice, through your authority is rightly administered, laws are enacted, and judgment is decreed. Assist with your spirit of counsel and fortitude the Board of Commissioners and other government leaders of Rockingham County. May they always seek the ways of righteousness, justice, and mercy. Grant that they may be enabled by your powerful protection to lead our county with honesty and integrity. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Gentlemen, you've had the agenda for about 10 days, but actually a little bit more than that, it's just time and a chance to review it. I would seek a motion to approve the agenda, and as necessary, adjust it.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion to approve the agenda and add item 1 and 2 to new business. Do I need to tell you what items they are? Approval of a subordination agreement between Rockingham County and Carter Bank and Trust and 287 partnership. Also, Golden Leaf Foundation approved funding 500,000 gallon elevated water storage tank in the amount of $2.2 million.
Commissioner Travis has given us a motion to approve the agenda with two amendments.
Second.
And second. Further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed by nay. It's approved. Now a very special evening for all of Rockingham County to recognize one of its heroes, one of its senior heroes. And I'm going to ask Commissioner Berger to take the lead on this. And as Commissioner, let me tell you how we're going to orchestrate this in a second. Four of us commissioners are going to come down on this side of the wall. Commissioner Berger is going to be on the other side of the wall, and we're going to ask you two folks to come up at that time. And I'm going to ask our county manager to read the resolution. So as soon as we get to place, would you do that?
Yes, sir. Resolution honoring Riley R. Rankin on his 100th birthday. Whereas Riley R. Rankin was born in Rockingham County on June 29, 1920, and whereas Riley R. Rankin was in the U.S. Army from September 3, 1942 until January 19, 1946, serving in World War II and being honorably discharged with the rank of Staff Sergeant, and whereas Riley R. Rankin married Marjorie McCain in 1948, and they had three children. And whereas Riley R. Rankin worked at Cone Mills at the White Oak plant, retiring after 30 years of service. And whereas Riley and Marjorie Rankin recently celebrated 71 years of marriage in December 2019. And whereas Riley R. Rankin is of the Methodist faith and a member of St. Paul United Methodist Church and was a devoted member of the American Legion in Reidsville. And whereas Riley R. Rankin was enriched, has enriched Rockingham County by faithfully serving his country, his community, his family, and has been a longtime fan of the Atlanta Braves. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Rockingham County Board of Commissioners does hereby honor Riley R. Rankin and expresses its appreciation for his decades of service to his county, to his community, and declares June 29th as Riley R. Rankin Day in Rockingham County. Happy 100th birthday, Mr. Rankin. Adopted this day, the 15th day of June 2020.
To meet because of the service that you've given this country. It's a privilege to have you here tonight, and we certainly appreciate everything that you've done for us. Thank you.
Mr. Rankin, also on behalf of the County Commission, we have here for you one of our county lapel pins, and as a Brave fan, it's my honor to give that to you tonight. So you can carry this, put that on your jacket, and I'll give this to your wife, and you can wear it for prize anywhere you go outside the county. Thank you.
If you would like to say anything, I know you've got a lot of people here that support you. We'd be glad to hear from you.
You want to say anything?
No, I ain't got
to do it. I'm glad to be here. You thank everybody for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes.
Thank you for your service, Mr. Commissioner. They're not here. You can't skip and come back.
I think it was. We're going to skip and come back. We're going to skip and come back.
Mark, we're ready.
You ready?
Everybody's here, yes, sir.
They will, let's wait.
Mark, if we can give them a few minutes to take some pictures.
Yeah. Let me get to the microphone there. We had already spoken to them. We didn't want to tax your family and Mr. Rankin too much, so you may take your time, get you all the pictures you want.
They want this in the back, in the background.
Commissioners, I suggest we go ahead and get in the background. The missing party has shown up, so we'll be ready for the next one.
Thank you. All right, so we have some people up here, and we have a great recognition to make tonight. But I want to give you a little bit of a background on this recognition, why we're making it, and what's going on. On the afternoon of April 10th, which was a Good Friday, at approximately 3:15 p.m., a tragic event occurred on U.S. 220. A vehicle traveled south in the northbound lanes of U.S. 220. Callers reported the wrong-way driver, but as these callers were dialing 911, the unthinkable happened. The vehicle traveling south in the northbound lanes collided head-on with the northbound vehicle. Unfortunately, the driver of the wrong-way vehicle did not survive his injuries. The driver and passenger of the northbound vehicle were struck head-on and were not supposed to survive that collision, but they did because they're here today. They're here today because of the efforts of three citizens who risked their own lives and a selfless act of bravery. The driver and the passenger did survive the collision, Mr. Anthony Sinclair and his fiancée, Regula Soto. As the vehicles struck each other, the wrong-way vehicle skidded into the grassy median on the northbound, and the northbound vehicle burst into flames. The flames quickly engulfed the vehicle. Anthony Flinchum. Anthony, stand up. Andy, stand up. He was operating a dump truck, and he came along, and he saw what had happened. He saw the carnage. He saw the flames. He immediately turned into the lifesaver mode, and he jumped into action. Andy got out, he grabbed a fire extinguisher from his dump truck, he ran to the burning vehicle, and he began to suppress the fire with a fire extinguisher. Tyrone Wade, is Tyrone here tonight? There you are, Tyrone. Come on up, sir.
Come on up, Tyrone.
Tyrone did the same. He had stopped for the vehicle, he had stopped for the collision, he had exited the vehicle, and without hesitation, without reservation, he ran to the burning vehicle to pull the victims from the fire. Tyrone gained access to the passenger, and he safely removed Regula from the fire. She was severely injured, and Tyrone moved her to a safe location and away from the fire. Alex CHEHAITLI, come up here, sir. He was off duty at the time, and he was attempting to remove the driver from the vehicle. I talked to Alex later, and Alex stated that he placed both feet on the side of the vehicle, and he pulled as hard as he could till the driver came out of the window and they both fell to the ground. With all the victims removed from the wreckage, Rockingham County EMS, Madison Rockingham Rescue triaged and prepared the patients for transport. The passenger was transported by ground by EMS to Cone Hospital, and Air Life Virginia transported the driver to Baptist Hospital. Stokesdale Fire extinguished the fire. The selfless acts of these gentlemen on April 10th saved the lives of these people that we have before us today. If not for the actions of these men, this would have certainly been a triple fatality, Rick. So we commend each of you gentlemen tonight for your selfless acts And one thing that we do in emergency services, we have awards, and I hope they'll show these to you in a little bit. On the front, they have our Rockingham County seal, and it shows Rockingham County Emergency Services, which is encompassed by the 911, the Fire Marshal's Office, EMS, and Emergency Management. On the back of these is the significant part, as it shows a heartbeat. When we present them to our people, usually in the field, our EMS crews, they turn people who have no heartbeats, which is the straight line, into people with a heartbeat, which obviously shows the EKG or the heartbeat. Well, these people did just the opposite. They took people with a heartbeat, and they kept them from going to the thin or the straight line. So they did an outstanding job, and due to your actions, these people are here tonight, and we commend you for that. Mr. Richardson has something for you as well.
I have some certificates basically saying what was said and recognizing folks. We're also going to bring Tyrone. I'm getting these things in order, I hope, here. And Alex?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
And we, Andy?
Thank you, sir.
We hope you will keep those certificates and honor this, and we hope you will keep the lapel pins that we're providing for you at this time, because it will remind you we're in a great place. Actually, it says you're in a good place, and it's a good place because there are people like you that are willing to be selfless and take care of our fellow citizens. So thank you so much. We have enough for the victims as well.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Does anybody have anything to say? Do you have anything to say? Or?
I don't think I've got all of them.
There you go. If you don't want to say
anything. I just want to thank all three of you guys.
Is it better than you know?
No.
Okay. Welcome, buddy. I'm going to change them, but I'm glad you're here.
I actually have some gifts. For
all of them.
I can get them out of
here. Thank you. That's awesome. When I seen it, I just thought I would do it. Anybody else would do it.
I thank you for saving my son and his girlfriend, right?
Yeah. That's awesome. I'm glad you're all right. Picture time, and we'll get whoever needs them. We will
organize
ourselves for that.
Yes, definitely.
You don't want to say anything?
Sir? Can we get everybody inside? Come on, copy.
I'm trying to stretch my neck.
Thank you.
Hey, Charlie.
I'm sorry, excuse me.
See if they wanted a picture with the highway patrolmen together.
That's pretty amazing.
I'm glad the right folks were there. Thank you, guys. We appreciate you being here.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Good luck. All the best.
Thank you, sir. Good luck.
Scary. Scary. Automobile on fire. Mm-hmm. Well, gentlemen, I think we're ready to move on to the rest of our agenda. And that is item 7, consent agenda. You've also had that for 10 or 11 days at this time. It consists of items that are generally non-controversial and are handled in a routine manner. However, if the public or anybody else has specific questions, please direct them to Lance Metzler, our county manager. Otherwise, having reviewed the agenda, consent agenda, we would look for a motion to approve it as provided.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion we approve the consent agenda as presented.
Motion to approve.
Second.
And second. Further conversation or questions? Hearing none, all in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed by nay. Nobody signed up for public comment, so we will move on to item 9. Lee Cochran, our economic director, if you'd come forward.
Thank you. So tonight we're going to be doing our second public hearing for the CDBG, so the Community Development Block Grant of $2.3 million for sewer extension for what was Project Optic that it now is for Ontex and the South Rockingham Corporate Business Park. And from this we will also, the total for the sewer project is $3,293,500, and of that, $993,500 will come from the county, and then $2.3 will come from the CDBG Community Development Block Grant.
Okay, if there's no more conversation, I'm going to declare the public hearing open and solicit any comments that might be available from the public. And Mr. Manager, would you confirm nobody has written in about this?
Yes, sir. Nobody's written in.
With no written comment or anybody here to add to the public hearing, I will declare it closed. And I think at this time, we are ready. We don't need a vote.
Yes.
We do.
Yes, I think you do.
Look at Bill. Look at Bill.
Counselor?
Yeah, we need it.
We need a vote.
I'll make a motion.
We have a motion there to approve. Do we have a second?
Second.
And a second. Further discussion or questions? Hearing none, all in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed by nay. Thank you, folks. We appreciate all of that. You have something else, Bill?
I just want to clarify. The motion to approve is to approve all of the things in the agenda packet, which would have been a resolution approving the administrative guidelines, policies, resolution to submit.
Everything in the agenda packet.
Okay.
Why don't we, just for the minutes, what all does Jennifer need?
Do you have one sheet or more for me to sign, is the question.
Well, no, motion. It can be one. I just want to make sure it's covered and kind of in the minutes to.
I'll amend my motion to include all four items included in the agenda pack.
Okay, I think it's best
and
to get it clear.
And four?
That's correct. And there's a resolution approving the overall administrative policies, resolution to submit. That's the key, get the application submitted. And there's a few policies that you're having to readopt that you've adopted several times in the past for CDBG projects. But these three are the only ones that are changed a little bit. All the rest of them have stayed the same, so we don't have to readopt them. But those three are assessment policy, fair housing resolution, and project budget ordinance.
Well, my motion reflects that.
All right. Confirming with the other four commissioners that you understand that his motion does reflect all four items as delineated by Mr. Bill Lester.
Yes.
And the second stood, and
yes.
and the vote said. So without any disagreement from the crowd, we'll move on to item 10. Dr. Shotwell, you're traveling incognito since I last saw you.
Sir?
You're traveling incognito since I last saw you, haven't you?
Yes, sir. I lost a razor about 5 weeks ago, so it's a little different. Probably summertime's not the best time to try it.
I've heard it said that a beard does not a Santa Claus make.
Well, gentlemen, thank you so much for having me here, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. I'm here to request a reallocation of the $100,000 that we requested originally for a chilling tower. And if you would indulge me just for one moment, just to let you know how we arrived at this point. Originally, we requested the money, the $100,000. It was going to be for a 200-ton chilling tower that would have been able to easily retrofit either at Rockingham County High School, the main building, or at the at Reeseville High School auditorium. The problem with Rockingham County High School was there was not enough tonnage. It needs about 75 more tons to handle that size building. And so that left Reeseville High School auditorium. The reason we picked that was because it was it's getting close to end of life. And when we looked at the savings that it would have, we could easily recoup the savings of that, of spending the $100,000, because it was going to save us about $16,000 over and above what we're spending right now per year for that unit. And the unit was going to be used. So the other thing was, this unit was normally over $200,000. And it was a company that it was designed for. It was not large enough for them. And we were under the impression, and so was Johnson Control, that they were willing to sell it and wanted to sell it. And so we were the first takers. Well, lo and behold, they decided that they're going to hold on to it. And so, you know, that kind of brings the question back up about why we're not pursuing something else to go in its place, because it would be over $200,000 to do that. And right now, we're not having any major issues with that unit over there, and we feel like we could get a few more years out of it. So we felt like that this other pressing issue came into play, which is South End Elementary School. One of the things, and Mr. Richardson and Mr. Metzler remember this from several years ago, you all were invited to participate in our land use study, where we had different planners from all over the county come together. It was 4 years ago, before we did our redistricting plan. And since that time, a lot of things have changed, because they looked at the conditions that we had back in late 2016, early 2017. And what has happened, that when you look at the Mall Street and the South End area, regardless of whether UNCG is in charge of it or not, there's approximately 126 more children living within that zone than was even projected to be there from the original study that we had done. Because at that time, the apartments over by Food Line had not come out of the ground. And so they had a formula what they were going to use. Well, one of our buses that goes through there fills it up with about 60 kids in that one stop going through those apartments. So we feel like there's been more children that moved into those apartments than had been originally anticipated, and also other areas of Reidsville. And so with that being said, the overcrowding at South End is not necessarily because we had to have an attendance zone and we made it South End. Because we did that because we were also picking up the kids for UNCG with our transportation. And so we felt like that was a better way to utilize our transportation and also still have the same feeder system for middle and high school. And the other thing that we put out there was that we really wanted to find out what our community wanted. And when we gave them the choice of moving the fourth and fifth graders, or possibly just the fifth graders, to Reidsville Middle School in a contained pod, the resounding answer to that was no. When we explained to them that there was also a possibility that we could redraw the lines, I think we presented two different options. The resounding comments from the community and parents was no. They said we'd like to have additional space. And as you know, we were looking at some new units. We even looked at a lease, both of which are really ultimately cost prohibitive, especially when you think about how if you can sell those units later. And even though the gentleman said the depreciation, even after 5 years, is not that great, it's still a used multi-use trailer. So what I did was I sent out an all call to the 16 superintendents that are in our region and asked them if they had any trailers that were available for sale. And we found three over at Yadkin County. My board has also instructed me to try to find a fourth one, but we did find three that really all they need is to be transported, set up, new carpet, painting, and then a decking and a covered walkway. And part of the regulations is that we have to be within 200 feet of access to a bathroom, and we do meet that qualification. Our rough estimate for at least the three units that we had was around $63,000 to include everything, because one of the requirements that we have is to provide footing for all three units. And so that added a little bit more of a cost. The gentleman said that he could bring each unit for $7,500 from Yadkinville to us for $7,500 apiece. And then we would do the rest of it. We also asked the possibility of Clayton Homes of doing a turnkey for us so that our maintenance staff is not taken away from projects from all the other schools this summer, and let them concentrate on that. And with that, our board resoundingly said that they would like to pursue that. And so we explained to them that we would have to come back to you all and ask for permission to reallocate those funds. Also, any funds that are not being used would also be used for painting some of our existing schools, some of the main hallways, and also covered walkways that you see. And we would have a local contractor perform that for us as well. So that's what I'm here today to present. is to ask your permission for that and answer any questions that you all may have.
Gentlemen, you've heard the story. I think we've heard it before, but any questions now?
Have we, Mr. Chairman, Lance, have we already, what's our balance in their restricted account, their restricted sales tax account?
I think right now it's roughly 2.7.
Is that?
It's projected that, because I know with this year's allocation, I think it was 1.6. All that's been obligated.
I know at the end of the next year it'll be 4 million, close to 4 million.
And is this encumbered in that amount, or is this already been transferred over to the school system, this 100,000 that we're talking about?
No, right? It actually stays here, and we pay for it and then ask for reimbursement. So, yeah.
Is it encumbered in that amount, or do you know?
I don't know.
Okay.
Well, I guess, are you somewhat referring to, since it was dedicated for the chiller?
Yeah. I just figured it was probably an encumbered amount, but that balance is not going to really make.
I was going to also tell you that we still have the money that's allocated for the track, and while the bid came in, over 100,000 under, I'm not ready to risk that opportunity here to move that money over to do something else, either for the chiller or for this, because they're still looking at the track, and there might be a chance they may have to put an extra half inch or 3/4 inch of asphalt around there, which could be another $50,000 to $75,000. So that's kind of where we are. And an update: our press box looks really good. It's getting the finishing touches. The outside of it is complete at this time, and they're working on the interior.
And Mr. Chairman, Rodney, is there a do you and the board have a long-term solution to the short-term fix that you're coming before us today?
Actually, we do. One of the things that the board did at their last meeting, and I appreciate you bringing that up. I've got all these notes, but I forgot that one crucial piece. So, thanks, Mr. Pirtle. What we asked for was that, really, from this point on, we're going to ask the group out of NC State or Ed to come in on an annual basis and work with Lee and all the other planners within the county on an annual basis to keep our plan up to date. What they're doing is we're asking them to come in, and they're going to deliver a land use plan to us in December. And at that time, I would have a better confidence if we were going to redistrict, and why, and have a reason. And the reason I say that is that at this time, Williamsburg stays almost at full capacity or just a little bit over. Bethany is over 500 students right now. Huntsville is at 450, 460. And that I see that changing too with Collybrook coming online. And then there's also been some other housing developments that are being put into place that could also maybe possibly impact South End or the Monroeton area. And when you look at that, then that leaves Lincoln over here in Ruffin, and then it leaves Wentworth. And during my 14 years here, I have seen Wentworth get to capacity, drop by about 70, stay that way for about 2 or 3 years, and then back up again. And what we're seeing right now is they're dropping next year. There's going to be about a 40-student difference. We've got about 100 fifth graders that are leaving, and I've got about 70 kindergartners coming in, and I don't have a fifth grade the same size. So I would feel more comfortable looking at a long-range plan for utilizing the space that we have. Also, that would also include the city of Eden as well.
Commissioner Travis. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Hey, Dr. Shelby.
How you doing, sir?
Fine. I understand the need at South End. The question I have is, why are you putting a chiller on the back barn burner? When you came before us to mm-hmm. ask that, it was a desperate need then. So it's still a desperate need. So why wouldn't you ask for a little bit more from your restricted fund to go ahead and take care of the chiller and this problem instead of putting it on the back burner? Let's go ahead and fix the problem since you already know it's there.
Well, right now, we were dealing with just the money that's allocated to us this year. And so at the beginning of July, we'll sit down with Pat, and we'll come up with, because remember, our quest is 2.8 million in our capital, and I know that's not what we're getting. So we've got that actually it's more than that, but we're looking at about $2.8 million in projects next year. I've got some roofs that are really more pressing than even that right now. And one of the reasons that we came to you was that, I mean, that was just a deal that you couldn't pass up.
Right.
And actually, the bid came in for installing it and everything at $88,000. You know, right. I mean, it was kind of one of those no-brainers at the right. time.
So do you have a list of all your capital projects and a list in order you want to accomplish?
We do. We have them with HVAC, roofs, and I forget what the other category that we set aside in there.
Can Lance get a copy of that?
Sure. We'll be glad to send that over to you.
Okay.
I wasn't too sure if that was included in the budget book, but I'll double check. But if not, I'll have it to you tomorrow.
Okay. That's all I have. Thank you,
yeah,
Dr. Shumway.
No problem.
I have no problem.
Other questions?
As far as some of your other school buildings in the Reedsville area, have you looked at the cost of upfitting those to get students back in?
We did look at Lawsonville, you know, and when you look at the cost of putting in these mobile units and then looking at how much money you would have to spend at Lawsonville, I mean, it's going to need a new boiler, a new roof. It's been the old part of Lawsonville has been sitting idle now for almost 5 years. So, you know, a rough guess, and then we'd have to repopulate the kitchen. I mean, that would be secondary to the roof and the boiler. But there would be a few things that we would have to upgrade over there. There'd be some asbestos removal as well, because some of the tile are starting to the 9-inch tiles are peeling up. But you're probably looking at about $2.5 to $3 million for that one building there. When you look at SCORE, the old Booker T. Washington building, even before it was an alternative school and after it was being used as a high school when we were segregated, it was used as an intermediate school. So it was for fourth and fifth graders. And so you would have to do some retrofitting in there with some of the bathrooms for the K-2 children, because the facilities are not to their size. And you'd have to have some covered walkways and some handicap ramps and access to the building.
Well, I personally think it makes a lot of sense what you're doing. We don't know what's going to happen to the school population in the coming year. There may be some attitudes changed amongst the parents having mm-hmm. gone through this COVID thing.
Yeah, I have one more comment. Rodney, this is just a kind of a 30,000-foot perspective, but from not getting into the weeds, one of my concerns is that ORED group, is that it, ORED?
ORED. Yes, sir.
Just this side of 3 years ago, come and recommended we close two elementary schools, and mm-hmm. now we're going to call them back and tell us to put some temporary classrooms outside elementary schools. And that's, I think that's a fair question that the folks mm-hmm. out in the community are going to ask, and going to ask us, and you know, what's your 30-second response to that?
Just 30 seconds, okay.
Yeah.
I feel like I'm on Final Jeopardy now. Well, what I would say to that is that, like I said, nobody projected that there was going to be such an influx of elementary age students coming into Reedsville, even when that study was done, because I can show you the 10-year projections for both of those schools, Mall Street and us, mm-hmm. and it's not anywhere. It's 126 short of where we are right now. The reason I would say this is because this is about as efficient of a, if you had to say, quick fix to deal with it, because, you know, otherwise we were going to have some classes that were going to, there's no more room. We've moved everybody who even had a classroom to have a classroom. We've even actually cut the media center and made two classrooms out of two-thirds of it. Mm-hmm. So we were running out of space. The lower class size, you know, we're going down one more student requirement, which meant that South End, based on the projections that they had, we're going to need two more teachers in the primary grades, which that's where it's affected. And also, you know, some folks might say, well, you're having a Spanish immersion class here. Why are you doing it? And you've got overcrowding. Well, the almost 90 to 95% of the kids that have signed up for it already lived in the South End zone. So we're offering a program. And it also allows to have a higher class size, because you've got to have that, because you're going to have some attrition over time. So, you know, I would say that I would rather do that than to make a rash decision of, you know, because people get upset about two things, their money and their kids. And we're messing with both. But in this case, I just feel like it's just really important to do this, at least temporarily, until we have that land use study and have somebody come in there who is looking at the 30,000 foot picture and saying to this board, these are our recommendations.
Well, I appreciate it. And like I said,
and I know that wasn't 30 seconds, sir. Sorry about that.
Well, this is restricted sales tax money, and is from my perspective, it's the school board's responsibility on how they best see to spend this. They're stewards of those tax dollars just as we are.
Commissioner Travis.
One quick thing. I know you're going to be looking at the whole big picture of the schools with capacity. Mm-hmm. I mean, I know what Monroe's at 67%. Reasonable Middle School's at what, 70-some percent?
Mm-hmm.
So
yes,
I think you're right on line. If you're looking at drawing different lines, I think that's probably a good way to go, especially in that little area, especially with Monroton. And I think, if I remember correctly, I can't remember, Williamsburg's not very full.
No,
it's close.
Williamsburg is.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
It's getting there?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yeah, they consistently have over 500 students.
So what's your time frame on looking at all this, or are you hiring an outside consultant, or?
Yes, sir. It's the group from NC State.
Okay.
And they have no openings this summer, because we ask them that first. But they could do one this fall, and that's when they're doing it. And so I feel like that we could have a recommendation after it's presented to the board, that we could come back to you all in late winter before we get into the budget season and talk about what are the different options and what a lot of the folks are leaning towards there. And at the same time, just like Mr. Metzler said, our reserve fund is increasing because Bethany was paid off this past September, and so our only debt right now is Douglas, and that's going to be there until 20, I think it's... There's three different fund sources that get paid off. One's going to be paid off in 2024, the other in 2027, and the other in 2030. And once that's done, every year we're starting to get into the black. It was that one year when we were doing the pool, Mr. Travis,
yeah,
that you remember,
yeah,
that we were in the red and had to go just a little bit, had to get a little bit of help from y'all on that,
right,
that year. So. So there are some opportunities there, but I also want to say, too, there's also a lot of roof needs.
Well, I just know, I can't speak for everybody on this board. I know we would love to be able to give schools a whole lot more money into what we
absolutely
can, but I think you understand we try to give as much as we possibly can. We know you got needs like track and tennis courts and stuff like that. I know it's a struggle for you and your staff to figure out ways. So it's also a struggle for us to figure out ways to do everything we need to do. So, but I appreciate you looking at it. I mean, every avenue you can go down and look and see if it saves taxpayers money, that's the best way to go.
Well, I just want to say to you all, thank you so much for holding us at the same level. That was very welcomed, and it's a point of pride, because I know that I have other districts that are taking cuts right now, and so for you all to make that commitment to us made a huge impact for the kids and the community here, and you all should be commended for making that as a priority, because you know that with economic development, what's done with education is going to have a huge impact on what you're going to be able to do on the other side there, and I want to be part of that journey We all do. Our board is right on board with you all on that, so we're very appreciative of that. And you all have always been very open, and you also have been, I hope you felt the same for when you give us suggestions, that same courtesy has been given back.
Let me ask you real quick, if you don't mind, Mr. Chairman. I know the school year's, you know, working hard on an upcoming school year, and I know a lot of changes are going to be taking place. When do you think you can come back and give the public an update on what their schools might look like?
Well, just
I mean, we would love for you to come back and be on TV and explain it and show a slide or something.
So basically what you're saying is you're asking for the exclusive interview.
Yes.
Okay, I got you.
We'll make room for you, Crystal.
Yeah, we'll make room for you.
Okay.
He wants to know if you can read Lloyd Cooper's mind.
That's right. That's what I want to know.
I'm just shaking my head.
Well, thank you so much. I'm sorry, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, gentlemen. And if y'all need anything, please let me know.
All right. Yeah, we need a motion on this, Mr. Chairman.
We do need a motion.
Yeah. So moved.
Second.
Moved and second. Further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Those opposed by nay. The ayes have it.
Thank you, gentlemen.
So next July? This July coming up?
Yeah. I'll be back over here in July. I'll let you know what's happening, man.
Thank you, Dr. Sharp.
Y'all going to buy all the plexiglass that we need,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, we're going to try to. We got a company in Breezeway that can help you out.
Yeah, I go in all these restaurants and stuff, and I see the different ways they've got their plexiglass up. I said, y'all mind if I take a picture of this?
Just call for point of order.
Anyway, thank y'all.
You want to go ahead and do it?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. Oh, thank you so much.
Mr. Berger.
Yes, sir. I think in our excitement to recognize Mr. Rankin and also the gentleman that saved the life of those two that were here earlier, we did skip over actually a vote to adopt the resolution to honor Mr. Rankin. So, right.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Okay.
Moved.
Second.
Seconded. Further discussion? Thanks for that point of order, Mr. Berger. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed by nay. Yeah, that made the evening, wasn't it? These two recognitions.
That was awesome.
Great stuff. Very nice. We're going to move on to item 11, and we're going to ask our astute engineer rather than Kerry Spencer to.
I was going to say, you looked a little bit different, Kerry.
Thank you, gentlemen. Astute engineer, that would probably be Bill Lester, but you got me instead. So tonight we've got a short presentation regarding extension policy, and with us is Eric Woolridge from Destination by Design. He's worked on some of these ideas, and he has a short presentation. I'm going to turn it over to him. Once he's finished, I just want a couple of quick notes about budget and things like that for the board to consider with this. With the extension policy, but I'll turn it over to Eric for his presentation.
Good to see you, Eric. Thank you for being here.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners. Good evening. I have presented to this board before, but it was over the phone. If you may recall from, what was that,
right.
maybe 2 months ago.
That's
or
right.
So, Kerry was clicking some slides for me and I was presenting. So my name is Eric Ward, Destination by Design. We're the firm that's working on the countywide land use plan and the Unified Development Ordinance rewrite. Okay, so we're moving along in that process. Oh, I'd say, 6 weeks ago or so, Lance and team got on the phone with me and asked that I kind of shift gears a little bit and kind of hone in on some of the infrastructure-related things first, and with that, help hone in on some of the policy work as well. Inside your packet, I provided a really simple presentation to you all that laid out a few key questions, and I'll just kind of go through those real quick. As we try to get towards what would an infrastructure policy look like for you all, particularly for unprogrammed infrastructure expansion, okay? But before we get into that, we wanted to talk about one is where are your target growth areas? I think that last conversation was pretty timely. The fact is the south end of this county is going to continue to grow and be impacted, particularly if you all adopt a land use plan that's kind of pointed in that particular direction. Secondly, we wanted to see how much infrastructure capacity do you all currently have? right now? And then how much capacity have you already committed? Okay? And then how much capacity do you all have to reserve in order to meet your growth goals? And then at the end of that, you all have an amount that's there. And the question becomes is, what's the county's policy for expanding infrastructure and yielding that capacity that's outside of those target growth areas? You're already running sewer, water in specific areas. I mean, that's a done deal. We know that. The question is what's going to be the policy for y'all expanding off of that system, right? Okay. So inside that presentation, which you all may have seen, it was the future land use map, which I went over with you all two months ago or so, right? That shows like where you're looking for growth. We're looking along the corridor and so forth. Inside that presentation, also provide you all with an infrastructure capacity analysis. All right, so I just want to go over this real quickly with you all before we go through the different policy recommendations. This is critical information. Shows how much water sewer capacity you all have, how much you've already committed, and then I think from this information you all can make a good decision about how you all want us as consultants and staff to move forward. Gallons per day, GPD, 700,000 is what's going to be available to you once all the MOU agreements are signed and so forth. GPD that's used to date on the water side is 35,000. You've already committed to five different projects. Okay, Gold Hill, Ahern, Colleybrook 1, we got Colleybrook Farm, and also Optic, which is now called something different. Onyx, okay. So those are already committed. So if we go through there and we look at the gallons per day related for water for each of those and sewer, we can see those numbers there. I talked to Bill a little bit earlier today, and it looks like some of the numbers are going to be a little bit lower, so you are going to have a little bit more capacity. Speaking with economic development, looking at where have you all reserved, where do you all need to reserve your capacity? We got the Carroll Site 2 that's open for industrial, or Carroll Site 2 that's open for economic development at some point in the future. There's up to 400 acres that the EDC knows that can expand for different economic development opportunities. Bill can speak to this more than I can, but to what extent will those be water users is a big question mark. So this number could be high. It's certainly a conservative number. One thing that we are recommending is down along Bennett Farm Road, in accordance with the future land use map that we presented 2 months ago, is how do we really take advantage of the water and sewer infrastructure to raise up density, to pull in some more housing units, get enough housing units, enough rooftops that would actually drive some commercial development so everyone's not just going over the line. So we are trying to hit a certain amount of rooftops to generate that private sector commercial development. And that's when you are going to see the tax benefits of that. Now, that's a very pertinent question about the school system. There, if you all adopt this policy and you run water and sewer and we try to aggressively go after rooftops, it's going to impact this. This is why you've got to pull in commercial development, and why when you start building a whole lot of residential communities, the ROI on that's really hard to meet once you start counting in policing everybody and EMS and school system. It's a very difficult ROI. But if you can get to a certain threshold, you can start pulling in the commercial elements. So what we would suggest is over the next 10, 15 years, you are trying to hit a target of 800 more dwelling units down in that area. Probably very achievable in that kind of time frame. Then in the one column here under the reserved, kind of to be determined, we say opportunistic connections. You start running a sewer line down there, there's people that already have businesses, homes, and so forth that are like, hey, we want to tap into that. So we all need to reserve some amount for those types of connections. We put in here an equivalent of 750 dwelling units, which could be businesses, could be homes, and so forth, which equals to 150,000 gallons per day. Again, maybe too aggressive. Maybe we could lower that. So when we run looking at your total capacity, what you have committed, what we think is reasonable to you to reserve, you can already see that you have a negative number here. You don't have enough capacity to do what we've laid out here. So we're going to have to make some policy decisions. I want to hear from you all about what's a priority from you all. And I think that we've also got to, you know, get our sharpen our pencils and figure out, hey, what's the priority? But I think this is a pertinent question as you all start talking about where you're going to let water and sewer start expanding to. So with that being said, as the backdrop, we presented five different options for you all as it relates to, it's actually more than that. No, it was five options for what we call an unprogrammed infrastructure expansion policy. I call it unprogrammed because you all have a program. You all have a growth strategy of where you're trying to drive water and sewer for job growth, economic development, and the like. The question is when someone comes and says, hey, I want you to, you know, do this or that, you all are wanting to have a policy in place. So I'm just going to make sure that we're all trying to answer the same question. Does that seem reasonable in terms of our approach to the project? Okay. So we provided five different options. Option one was the return on investment cost share, and option two was the tax increment reimbursement. I believe, Lance, correct me if I'm wrong, but a meeting or three or four ago, you all presented some of these options that I'd put together.
Yes, very, very similar to those.
Yeah,
yes.
Okay. Option three was the property lien option, where you all would actually hold a lien on the individual plats that were divided into the amount you all used to expand the infrastructure. And then once they 50% of those properties got a CO, then you all remove those liens. So that's another option. The bond works very similar to that. And then option five, as is in your packet, is the target growth strategy, where you say, hey, we have a plan. This is where we're running water and sewer infrastructure. This is what we're trying to do from a land use economic development perspective. If you're trying to expand outside of that, it's going to be on your dime. But you all, from a policy perspective, have said, this is how we want to grow. This is why we're trying to grow this way. And anything outside of that just doesn't make sense for us to pay for ourselves, because you all have commitments to meet these different target growth strategies. So those were the five options that I put together. I'm obviously not going through all of the different items pertaining to each of those, but with that, I wanted to kind of step back and see what questions you all had about those various options or the capacity analysis and the like. And if I missed anything, do I have anything else to add?
Okay, gentlemen, questions?
Mr. Chairman, I think one of the key questions that of the five beginning questions that were at the beginning of his PowerPoint, I think there's a sixth key question missing, and that's the availability of resources at the time of the request. Mm-hmm. I think that's going to drive our decision making of the any this board or any future boards. Is one, what resources you have available to address the request, or the willingness to take on debt service to address the request. So I think that's something when we talk about these options listed that we keep in the back of our mind, that's something that we'll have to consider too, is that all these are going to be that's going to weigh into the decision of this board and any future board.
I agree with you, Mr. Pirtle, but in two ways, resources in terms of financial assets we have available and the ability to raise that 700,000 gallons to a higher figure.
Well, I think, too, you also have, when considering this, and keep in mind this is what is outside of our target areas is what we're talking about. We want to encourage development, but not and also continue to encourage, expand our infrastructure so that we get more customers. Yes. And at the same point in time, I don't want to discourage the developer from making the investment. So those are two additional considerations when I sit and think about the presentation.
Mr. Metzler, you had a point.
I just wanted to make you aware that we have talked to both Madison and Mayadan, and they had, Bill, I think that you were at the last meeting. Did they both agree to agree for excess capacity?
The MOU?
Yes.
Yeah, they both approved the MOU in the last meeting. Absolutely. And I think in an offline meeting, it sounds like Mayadan leadership is open to future. You know, they obviously don't promise it until you meet it. They'd like to leave that open for the future. And Madison asked about that, and then Madison came conduit you're talking about, taking that bottleneck out, that's some of the CIP stuff you're talking about, and they know that there's a need, and they asked quite honestly at the board meeting most recently if that was more capacity going through Mayadan, or were we looking at wastewater treatment plant? I said, we have looked at all of the above.
Those numbers that you see in the 700,000 include yes. that MOU that was just approved. So it would be additional capacity at this point. That 700 is what we have, even with the new MOU.
But what I'm understanding Bill to say is they're open to more. certainly they're not going to obligate everything to the county, but what kind of capacity numbers are they sitting at?
Made in wastewater treatment plant of 4.5 million gallons per day plant. They're probably not hitting third of that right now. They're probably less than 1.5. Except on wet days, these older systems on the western part of the county have inflow and infiltration. Say they're probably best in the third. And again, the capacity I think is there, but like any municipality there, they've agreed to the MOU, but and they said yes, if we still have it in the future, and there's a need, they would discuss it. I think they think probably, and I don't think they know this, will there be any expenses to them to try to get ready for that? They just like to get close to that and know that. I think I've heard, not even in a conversation with them, they some of their flow may have dropped because of the community. There could have been a drawback on water usage too.
But I do also think it's important to note around Eric's point and to Bill, for increased capacity, there will be increased infrastructure needs, especially around sewer. So as and even with the 700,000, there will be, and I'm not exactly sure what that capacity number is, but it's about we're going to have to make Madison pump station and force main upgrades that are going to be about $2.7 million. And if we do water booster pump at the corporate park future expansion, that's about 1.1. So I do think it's important, as you, Commissioner Hurdles mentioned, as you think about resources for some of these, you know, smaller development projects, that we don't forget about large dollars that are going to have to be expended at some point to continue to build out this portion of the county.
We've developed a lot of those CIP numbers too. They exist, and there's some mapping that Eric's got that's operating in the background, some things that may come back in the future.
So we're looking at about almost $4 million of upgrades that eventually we know we're going to have to make, because we will continue to grow that area.
And Commissioner Berg, when I was answering that question, I felt like I was answering wastewater, because water is probably a little easier to get an increase.
Other questions from the commissioners?
As far as any areas of growth, I'm certainly hopeful that we're relying on our citizen group and their input with this UDO, and not relying on staff for those growth areas.
Yes, the future land use map that was presented and that's in this presentation was vetted by them. In fact, it was modified because I'd presented a draft to staff, and then we said, all right, let's get the committee together. And so it was after that meeting that we presented this, the last round. And, you know, we're still in the midst of all of this, right? We're still trying to weigh all of these different decisions as well. So we're on that same course.
Commissioner Travis.
Yes, sir. Thank you. I'd like also to see what other counties are doing, too. If you can provide them with whatever you present us to, so I can see what other counties are doing. I mean, we're not reinventing the wheel.
You're not.
It's been done before, so let's see what other counties are doing.
Yeah, and we've probably reached out to close to 10 other jurisdictions throughout the last 3 months, and so those are reflected here. I didn't want to get any more long-winded than I already am. But for the most part, people are jurisdictions are expanding sewer or water into certain areas, and developers are having to run it, you know, from those, because people just don't have the resources to do that. Or like you all said, like, and it goes kind of without saying, you all might say, hey, we're going to take $250,000 a year for any, pick any one of these policies and say, hey, this is the max you're going to allot towards any of these, but you're going to have to set some number.
Most places are probably not losing $600,000 a year on their water and sewer.
That's probably
true.
Right.
True.
Yeah. Ron,
I just want that out there for the public, because I hear that we're doing something a little bit different than a lot of places may be doing, but we're in a much different situation.
Need to grow a customer base.
We've got to have a customer base.
Yeah. And that's what I was getting at when I was talking about it. Growing the customer base without discouraging the development, so to speak. It's a fine line. I know Lance and his staff has done a magnificent job in reducing that number, and along with the banks, but it's still we're subsidizing our enterprise fund from the general fund to the tune of it's about four next year.
It's gone down,
but it's going to be about four next year.
Ronnie, your point.
Yeah, I was just going to comment on what Commissioner Pearl and Berger both said about a lot of these policies that we looked at from other municipalities or counties. They have very healthy enterprise funds. It's sort of the opposite of what we have, and they can afford to do some of these expansions out of that enterprise fund money. And Commissioner Travis, to your question, we did look at several of them, and most of what we found are compiled in Eric's list of recommendations. But again, a lot of those places have funds in place to pay for expansion.
Right. My biggest concern is I want to be able to read what other counties are doing. I understand y'all did the research. I want to see it so I can develop my opinion, because several options I like. One of the options I don't like is spending a certain amount of money every year on projects, because to me that leads to misuse and abuse, because we're not going to be up here forever, and you might get a different board that might want to help their friend or buddy out and spend $100,000 on a project they got. And I just need something fair and equal across the board for everybody, so nobody can have any kind of misuse or abuse on it. That's all I'm asking.
Out of curiosity, was Handy Sanitary one of the districts you looked at?
Which one?
Handy Sanitary.
That's in Montgomery.
No, it does do Montgomery it. And Davidson.
God
and
bless. No, we didn't.
Well, that's how not to do it.
Yeah, that's not how to do it.
Other questions, gentlemen?
Yeah, we had two. We had Orange and we had Handy.
Now, were you hoping to walk away with a steer? Because I don't believe we're ready to give you the steer.
No. Excuse me, if you don't mind. Our goal was to, as we had mentioned before, we wanted to provide you all with options. So I guess we've kind of done what we needed to do as far as provide options, and we'll get additional information out about the other what other counties do. I guess the next step, we'll get direction from you all as far as you absorb these options. Just give us direction as far as what option you would like us to proceed, or options.
Well, let me ask you this, Mr. Chairman. We don't have to pick an option. We can implement certain aspects of each option and make our own option,
yeah.
Right?
Well, certainly, and my expectation would be over time our priorities are going to change, and would affect necessarily the option general procedures that we want to follow. I don't see it as a static situation.
Right. Okay.
Thank you.
Is that fair, Eric?
Well, I just, Mr. Chairman, I just think we need something in place to give us some guidance on in this particular area. And I understand what my colleague, Mr. Commissioner Travis, is saying, but you know, we got before us the gentleman who and staff who has done the research.
Right.
They provided us with their best synopsis of what others are doing, although they didn't name which counties is doing which out in the margin. They still provided us with what the others are doing, and I just hope that this board, at some point in time in the near future, we move to give the manager some guidance, because I think he's been waiting, and we've had situations come before us here in the last 6 months. And as Commissioner Travis stated also, that we want to be fair and consistent with our decisions. And to do that, I think we need guidelines in place.
I agree, but another thing you said earlier there, Commissioner Pearl, had to do with resources. Right now, we're a little insecure about resources on all budget fronts. So I agree with you about some sort of basic starting point.
Oh, I'm saying we just need the guidelines. Yeah. The resources will dictate what we can do, but when we got the resources, then we, you know, the time to do the guidelines is not when you got the money, but have it when you have a plan in place so that you can execute.
Well, I mean, I'm with you. I definitely like the, I guess, a algorithm of cost sharing aspect of it. I like that, coming up with a formula per house. If somebody's going to develop, we don't know, we'll cost share. I like that, but there's other things I like. And I know Commissioner Berger mentioned something about liens. I mean, I'm interested in that too. I just didn't want to do anything to hinder any kind of growth. Some people don't like having property if they got to put a lien on it, you know, and I don't know how that aspect works, you know, so I just got to do a little more research on my part, I guess.
Yeah, and I don't know if you found, I haven't found any other jurisdiction that has done that.
I didn't see any that were doing that specific model.
And I definitely agreed, this board, I think we're all in agreement that we should invest a certain amount every year towards this project to get that dwelling number up. I just don't know what the number is.
But you indicated the other jurisdictions that you looked at were not suffering the deficit that we are in enterprise fund.
They're funding projects out of their enterprise fund, and that tells me they have healthy enterprise funds that they can do that with. I didn't see anywhere, I don't think, where they were funding out of general fund dollars.
No. Mr. Chairman, I would love to hear what the other commissioners, what they want to see, so we can pinpoint this down to give the staff direction.
I don't think we're ready to do that.
Our current policy is a discretionary policy based on available funds. And that discretionary policy, at least the ones that we've seen at this point, look at the area of the county, the potential growth, and the potential number of customers off of whatever we run, whether they're primary customers or secondary customers. Those are the criteria that we've gone with up to this point. So beyond that criteria, what, if any, changes to that existing policy would anybody want to see? The idea of whether it's developer investment, whether it's liens, the lien part would coincide with developer investment and just kind of be a subpart of that. And so the real question is, at this point, whether we want to amend that current policy or continue on as is. I think in the upcoming budget, Lance put, I remember, $100,000.
That fund has roughly $650 in it.
It's $650 at this point. You know, the current year out of the general fund, round about $350 was spent. The other $300 and so was spent out of the state funds that we received for water and sewer expansion, which is now exhausted.
It will be after we commit that other amount.
Yes. And so we've got $650 in the fund now annually. If we can continue to fund that, that gives us a base to work off of. And it's really just a matter of what, if any, changes to that current policy do we want to work off of.
Well, I mean, I definitely see that we got to change something. I mean, because one developer, we're running it all through their development. The next developer, we can't even get it to their property line. So we definitely got to have some policies in place so it would be equal across the board on any kind of requirements.
I don't think either one I voted on ran all through anybody's development.
Well, Harry Rakestraw's property, we ran it all the way down their streets for them.
No, we didn't.
Right away.
Right away.
Right. We didn't run it into any interior streets. So
stayed on the state right away.
Yeah. And the other one, we got it. I mean, it's to the edge of the property.
Yeah.
So.
Mr. Chairman, one of the things that I would like to see, or that I think this board should consider, is that when we start looking at outside of our targeted growth areas, I think we need to look at a realistic number for our return on investment.
True.
And whatever we decide on, if this board selects, I think here in example one, it's listed as a 10-year ROI. And if we get outside of that 10-year, that's on the developer. You know, he prorated to, and I think Commissioner Berger and I had a brief conversation about this.
Yeah, I like
that. I think that, to me, that's one of the things that we need to think about. And I don't think, to me, I think it's doing that. We are, it's a smart move with county dollars. Yeah. And I think a developer, if he's serious about it, he will see that as an opportunity for him.
Yeah, I like it.
Well, I don't know what the magic figure is, but I agree in concept with you. And I would ask the county manager, from a pure financial point of view, has Pat looked at that? Does she have a recommendation on what a reasonable time length for an ROI that's
she's going based on our experience. I mean, I know that when I was in Montgomery, we had a 10-year return on investment that we looked at typically. And you can ask Eric what his experience
is. What's your recommendation?
I mean, if you want my honest opinion, I feel like 10 years is very generous.
Do what? Say it again.
I feel like 10 years is very generous, but reasonable. You still are taking on the risk, right? The other thing is you're looking at a potential slow build out. And there's a lot of things that can happen that affect an ROI. So I think 10 years is generous. I mean, if you guys are serious about trying to attract development and get people going, so I'm not saying that word in a bad way. Mm-hmm. I'm saying, like, you know, that's come do business is what's that saying to me.
That's exactly
now,
what I'm going to
say. I could have written item on option 1.5 a little bit better, because it's exactly what you're saying there, Commissioner. You know, the developer will be responsible for any expenses necessary to ensure that the county ROI is met within 10 years. You know, if additional dollars are required in order to make that ROI, say you did your formula right now and it came out to 15 years, well, the developer have to come in to offset that to make that amount come down, and that money would have to come into the pot immediately. Now, there's some other things you can start doing with this option. You can say it's going to be say you hit the 10-year mark, well, you're going to come in with half of that up front, and then after you sell so many lots, it comes back to you in the form of a grant. You can do a variety of things like that, pulling kind of out your economic development hat to kind of create some protection. But I do think working around option one, if you all want the simplest, because it's basically a modification of your current policy, as you just mentioned. But the problem is the protection, because it's my understanding that you all aren't very excited about bonds, you know, because that's the other way that you could protect yourself as well.
How would that work?
You could require them to provide a bond that they get the houses built by a certain amount, and you guys are receiving fees on those. And if that's not met, then you pull that bond to get some percentage of that back to the county. I mean,
I think that
it's going to be a tough sell.
I mean, that was one of our board's concern too. These developers would say they would build, for example, 100 houses, and we would spend all this money to invest for them to do that, but it's no guarantee that they would build 100 houses. And they got a certain amount of tenants, and a lot of developers were complaining, hey, you can't, you know, hold me to 10 years to build 10 houses or 100 houses.
Well, I think eventually you got to get there.
Yeah.
You know, you got to put your money where your mouth is.
Exactly. If the market can't stand it, why are you taking on the burden? Why should the county take on the burden, right? That's
right.
Kind of the logic around it.
And I mean, I like that idea.
And we would be negligent with public money if we committed taking on a greater risk than the developer.
Is other counties doing the ROI with a bond?
I don't know that I saw a combination like that.
And you didn't see liens either. Is that correct?
No. Didn't see liens.
I guess life is good if you got a lot of money in your enterprise fund, right?
Yeah.
Well, that's fair.
Yeah.
That's fair to me. I like it.
Yeah, but that wasn't the bond, like the ROI bond combination.
No, it was more.
That's more, that was actually paying to run the whole line out there to the development.
Right. He
paid
it, and the
house
would pay it back.
Yeah.
Well, let me ask you this. The other jurisdictions you looked at, Eric, did they have 10-year payouts on their ROI?
I'm not sure where I don't know if the 10-year came from your experience.
It came
Lance.
From my experience. I don't know if
yeah.
it came from anywhere else.
I don't know that.
You can make it 7, you can make it 12.
What's normal?
Yeah.
What's normal is probably something closer to option 5. Target growth strategy, this is where we're running water and sewer. You want to tap into our line, then you're going to have to pay to get it there. Unless it's part of the strategy and it's part of the CIP and that plan is already being played out.
Well, we're right back to where I guess Senator Kevin Berger was talking about. We get a certain amount of money every year. We invest it the way we think target growth is going to go.
When you look at the land use plan and you talk to economic development and you see how much resources it's going to take to get you all to where I think you're trying to get to, it's a lot of resources. That's quite a capital outlay right there.
It's aggressive.
So that's why, I'm still delving into these numbers, make sure you all have all the information you need to make the decision that you want to make. But I understand the pressure, too. Like, we need some more customers in the pipeline. So
Well, gentlemen, I think whatever else we do, we need to have a time period that we think is reasonable to get our investment back, be that 10 years or whatever expert assessors can tell us what that is, because that's going to be a starting point to determine how much money we would need to allocate each year.
Mr. Chairman, I mean, this is such an important issue. It's really hard to come to a conclusion during an open meeting, a commission meeting, maybe a half a day work session on just this issue so we can resolve it.
Or, Mr. Chairman, maybe you should consider appointing a committee, perhaps getting the manager and perhaps Commissioner Hall, since he has a background in construction, or Kevin, since he has a background in water and sewer, and let them come up with a recommendation to us as a body as a whole, and move forward. We can sit and have this discussion.
We just can't wait another 6 months for this to be done.
Well, I think this is important for the entire land use plan to get this piece sorted out early, and you guys, quality control, I check, and I, certainly Commissioner Hall would come with more experience with the construction part of it, and we got to have the county manager, and Eric, we've got to have you and our engineer and residents to basically the same folks that are that I'm looking at right now would seem a committee that could do this, Mr. Pirtle, and either Mr. Hall representing us or one of us can go along with him.
I'd definitely like to have Kevin and Commissioner Hall on it.
That's fine.
Okay. I mean, I like both their ideas, what they got, so I like their input on it.
I think this board would be well represented by Commissioner Hall and Berger on this, and if I'm hearing a motion to put a task force together to assess this, consisting of the county manager, the three of you, and Commissioner Berger and Hall.
I'll definitely make the motion. I just want a deadline set for it to come back before so we can go ahead and put it in place.
Well, I don't know if I have to have a deadline. I'd kind of like to.
Since they both kind of run their own business, they're going to have to coordinate their schedules. Not tax them of that.
We'll start.
I would ask you to come back and recommend when you can give us a reasonable sort of.
Speedy.
All right, I'm taking Mr. Commissioner Travis's motion.
To form a committee.
I'll second it since volunteering two of my colleagues.
Did we drop off your Christmas card list there, Charlie Hall?
That'll teach me.
I've been off Mr. Berger's list for a long time.
Well, I mean, Commissioner Berger.
Moved
and
seconded. Moved and seconded. Further discussion. Hearing none. All in favor of this task force going to work and giving us at some reasonable time, like our next meeting, how much time you do need?
Yeah, we don't meet once in July, so it'll be August.
Lance, between you and Ronnie, you can work
I'll
out the details of time and when and where, all of that.
Okay.
Further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed by nay. Thank you, Commissioners Berger and Hall, for being volunteers.
Thank you, Eric.
Eric?
Yeah, thank you, Eric.
I'm going to ask one more question of Ronnie.
Yes, sir.
All right, between you guys, can you live with what we just did?
I think it's a great idea.
Okay.
Did you include Lee as part of that group?
No. At this point,
you didn't exclude.
I think it's up to the committee to draw in whoever they need expertise-wise.
I need Bill Lester. I need some of those members of the citizen group and Charlie and
I would definitely
Lance
ask for a
and
developer.
Beyond that until we get some ideas in place. Sure. I mean, you've got to come up with the ideas before you come up with where it's going.
How you can. So. Okay.
Yeah. I would naturally assume you have license to choose who you want to help you out.
Okay.
Yeah. Bring half the county.
Okay. Item 12 has two new items. Under new business, Golden Leaf Foundation.
Okay. So we'll start with the Golden Leaf Foundation. So last Wednesday, we received the official award letter from County Manager Metzler did from Golden Leaf, awarding $2.2 million for the 500,000 gallon elevated storage tank, which will be in the South Rockingham Corporate Business Park, and it will serve Ontex, Project Optic, but it will also serve that whole area. So not only industries, but also any residential developments or homes that are on that line for pressure and flow. So we would like to have approval to have Lance sign this. The attorney has looked it over and doesn't have any issues with the agreement, but we'd like to get this signed and sent back with a July 1st start date.
Okay, understand.
Okay.
$2.2 million. Anybody move to accept this?
So moved.
Second. Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Hearing none. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Opposed, nay.
And then, are you ready for the next one?
Ready for the next
one. Okay. The next one is the subordination agreement that we have spoken about previously. This is between the county and Carter Bank and Trust and 287 Partnership, which is going to be the former Ball Building property. This will move the county into a second position under a $5.4 million deed of trust for 287 with Carter Bank and Trust. So we just need formal approval to sign these documents. And
I make a motion for approval, Mr. Chairman.
Have a motion for approval.
It'll be a motion to approve and authorize the chairman to execute those on our behalf.
I amend my motion.
Second.
And second. Further discussion? Commissioners, are all clear what exactly is happening here?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed by nay.
Thank you.
Chairman, what's the height of that water tower going to be? Do you have any idea? How high?
150 to 160 feet.
A great place for some.
What sort of pressure head are you going to have out of that?
Yeah. At the base of the tank, that'll be in the 60 to 65 psi range.
Yeah.
Pretty much a high form Sylvania road. As an odd fact, that ground is salt.
Okay. Are you going to tell me our tower is going to sink into the soft soil or something?
No, we're going to drive piles to keep it from doing that. But it costs a little more to do that. But you expect it to be tight clay and rock in that part of the world, but it is salt and soil.
Yeah, you don't remember the previous conversation you and I had, and we talked about water pressure for fire suppression at the hydrant. So you're comfortable that we're going to meet those requirements?
We will have in the 60s there and anywhere that area serves, and the flow will be 2,500 to over 3,000 gallons a minute, depending on how
far. Pretty good.
And that sits right in the middle of the corporate park property.
Yeah.
Any increase, Lee, you'll take care of.
I trust your engineering. I trust your engineering, but it's a key factor there.
That's right.
All right. Gentlemen, if you have no further questions in regard to this, we're going to move on to commissioner comments. Mr. Travis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to thank everybody coming out. Let me just say that I appreciate all the citizens of Rockingham County. I know there's a lot of stuff going on in the world and in the United States, and I just ask everybody to treat everybody like you want to be treated. Let's respect each other, and let's respect our spaces, and, you know, just treat everybody like you feel like you should be treated too. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Travis. Commissioner Berger.
Yeah. Thank you, everyone, for coming out tonight. We had a wonderful beginning of our meeting, honoring Mr. Rankin, his 100th birthday, his service to our country, and we certainly appreciate his family being here. And then the recognition, the selfless acts of the three individuals, Mr. Tyrone Wade, Alex CHEHAITLI, and Andy FLINCHUM, saving that gentleman and his girlfriend from the burning car. It certainly didn't go without me noticing you could not find a more diverse group of people that put aside their differences, or the differences we see in the country today certainly were not evident when someone's life was on the line. And we certainly appreciate their selfless acts and standing up for the gentleman in need.
That's right. Good comment.
Thank you very much.
Yes, sir.
That's real good.
Commissioner Pirtle.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commissioner Berger, I'll echo exactly what he just said. He went first, so he got to say it first. It was an honor and a privilege to be here for the resolution of Mr. Rankin. That's one of my favorite things, is when we recognize one of the great members of the greatest generation. And we had one in attendance tonight. And anytime that I feel like that I personally have an opportunity to have an audience with one of those members of that generation, it's a privilege. And I don't take them for granted. And then secondly, that was quite a story we had tonight on that recognition of those heroes, hometown heroes, that rescued the two people in that car accident. So unfortunate that someone lost their life, but those three individuals that jumped out of their vehicle, risked their own safety, their own lives, to put out a burning car on fire and pull another human being from a car that they didn't know, just says a whole lot about their character and the folks here in Rockingham County. Commissioner Berger said earlier what a diverse crowd it was. It was a very diverse members of the lifesavers as well as the victims. And it's a shame that the news media outlets that shows all the civil unrest in our country wasn't here tonight to see that diverse crowd, the human aspect of what we recognized here tonight. This past Sunday, Mayor David Myers kind of led the charge on the Pray for Your Country Sunday, and talk about healing for our country. And I know we talked about that here in Rockingham County, and a lot of churches participated. I want to thank Mayor for leading that charge, but that's something we should continue to do. We're very fortunate to live in Rockingham County, where you have folks just like that right there. That was such a selfless act. And the human beings that the human elements, so to speak, of that of their kindness is overwhelming. I've seen a lot of tears flowing as that story was being told. And if you weren't here to see a mother thank three gentlemen for saving the life of their son, you missed a good show. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Perk. Mr. Hall.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Again, I agree, it was a wonderful demonstration of the best of humanity tonight, and it was a blessing to be here. It was wonderful to see the room full after so many weeks of isolation and us kind of meeting here by ourselves. It was wonderful to have a lot of people here, and that was very nice as well. I'd also like to take this opportunity to wish happy birthday to Ms. Leola Metter. Now, Ms. Metter has been a lifelong educator here in Rockingham County. She was actually my typing teacher at Holmes Middle School years ago. But she's also been a leader with the 4-H, the Betsy and Jeff Penn Center, and also across the state. She has gotten many awards. She has actually been inducted into the Electric Awards Endowment, is named in her honor. She's been elected to the Hall of Fame in the 4-H here in North Carolina. So happy birthday, Ms. Metter. Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Commissioner Hall. I echo all of the praise for our heroes, the ones from 1945, and also the ones from 2019. And if all of our citizens exhibit those sort of characteristics, we have reason to be very optimistic. I want to take off some on what Commissioner Pirtle was talking about, and it started with Mayor David Myers, but it includes all the mayors and the commissioners of this county in support of Unity Sunday. And I would say to the public, Unity Sunday was an opportunity for folks to get together where they could, but as a whole county, pray for unity and the sort of characteristics that we observe tonight or honor tonight. Mayor Myers deserves full credit for that. but it's obvious at this point that it's going to take more than prayers. It's going to take effort from individuals. And I think we have that sort of population here in Rockingham County, and I hope we put action behind those words. And we take not only inspiration, but a good example from our local heroes that we were able to see tonight. That said, gentlemen, you will be happy to know that we do not have a closed session, so I would accept a motion to adjourn. Move.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed by nay.